Wings of Fire. Moon Rising. By Tui T. Sutherland. Welcome to Jade Mountain Academy. At this school, you will be learning side by side with dragons from all the other tribes. So we wanted to give you some basic information that may be useful as you get to know one another. You have been assigned to a winglet with 6 other dragons. The winglet groups are listed on the following page. Thank you for being a part of this school. You are the hope of Perea's future. You are the dragons who can bring lasting peace to this world. We wish you all the power of Wings of Fire. The Jade Mountain Prophecy.
Beware the darkness of dragons. Beware the stalker of dreams. Beware the talons of power and fire. Beware one who is not what she seems. Something is coming to shake the earth. Something is coming to scorch the ground. Jade Mountain will fall beneath thunder and ice, unless the lost city of night can be found.
Prologue. 4 years ago. The volcano was restless, and so were the dragons in the Nightwing Fortress. Secret Keeper felt the mountain rumble under her talons as she hurried through the stone halls. There were too many dragons awake, too many witnesses who might wonder where she was going in the middle of the night. She kept her head down, but she felt the curious looks sliding under her scales with each dragon she passed. How many of them knew what tonight should have been? Did anyone remember? She didn't need to count days to know. Her bones ached with knowing. It was like a voice in her head screaming,
"Tonight, it's hatching! Hurry! Don't get caught! Hurry!"
Because if it happened, and she wasn't there, she imagined hungry panthers prowling the undergrowth, dangerous crocodiles with gleaming teeth, or unpredictable, curious, idiot dragons who might do anything with a mysterious, abandoned egg. But she couldn't run. Not with other Nightwings still awake and watching her. Why tonight? Of all nights. Usually everyone in the tribe slept like sloths from dusk to dawn. But just before she reached the ledge, she passed Mastermind and Farsight. Mastermind gave her a hard stare.
"He knows," she thought with a stab of panic.
But it was Farsight who stopped and spoke to her.
"Oh, Secret Keeper, poor dear," she said, folding her wings.
Secret Keeper winced. Her name had never sounded more appropriate. Sometimes she wondered if her name had made her this way, if she was unconsciously trying to live up to it with the biggest, most unforgivable secret a Nightwing could have.
"The egg you lost was due to hatch tonight, wasn't it? Are you all right?"
Farsight went on.
"Do you want someone to sit with you?"
"No."
Secret Keeper curled her claws in and shook her head.
"I'm fine," she said. "Just going to get some air." "Do you want company?"
Farsight asked. Behind her, Mastermind frowned irritably.
"I know it's not the same, but when Marrowseer took my egg..."
Secret Keeper could only think of one way to stop her, and it was harsh. She had to. Because she had to go right now.
It's not the same at all,
she snapped, shooting a burst of flame out her nose.
You have two surviving dragonettes, and one of them is off on the continent being pampered and overfed and worshipped by the Talons of Peace. So don't try to act like you understand me.
Farsight recoiled as if Secret Keeper had bitten her. Mastermind looked startled, perhaps a bit impressed, maybe a little suspicious. Secret Keeper whirled and fled up the corridor before either of them could say anything else.
I'll apologize tomorrow. She'll forgive me. Farsight is like that.
She took a running leap off the ledge and soared down toward the black sand beach. Behind her, the volcano rumbled again. The dark clouds overhead glowed with an ominous red light. The air was heavy and suffocating, smelling of death and rotten eggs and burning rocks. Secret Keeper swooped low over the red-gold lava river, the brightest spot on the island, and then veered toward the cave. Only one guard tonight. Nobody really believed any of the rainforest dragons would find their secret tunnel. The guards were often asleep when she came, and Secret Keeper had frequently been able to sneak past without waking them. But not tonight. Prey Hunter was sitting out on the ledge overlooking the beach, watching the volcano and fidgeting nervously.
"Do you think it'll be tonight?"
he asked her as she landed beside him. It took her a frightening, disoriented moment to realize he hadn't guessed her secret. He probably didn't even remember that she'd lost her egg. She was only one of many dragons who had in the last few years, after all. He was talking about the volcano.
No,
Secret Keeper said, looking back at the hulking shape that loomed over all their lives.
It can't be. Mastermind said we have more time before it erupts.
Prey Hunter snorted.
Right, and I'll remember why we trust him any minute now.
She knew what he meant. If Mastermind was wrong, well, that was why she'd made her choice, wasn't it? That was the whole reason for her dangerous secret.
Where are you going at this hour?
Prey Hunter asked, eyeing her up and down.
Shouldn't you have backup for night hunting?
I'll be all right, Secret Keeper said. I just can't sleep, and I thought maybe I'd better bring back a sloth or a boar for greatness to give the queen.
Ah,
Prey Hunter nodded slyly.
Keeping the queen happy. Always a good idea. Right. See you soon, then.
Secret Keeper edged past him, her heart pounding. She bolted through the cave and into the tunnel that led to the rainforest.
Hurry! Hurry! It's happening now! You have to be there!
She fell through into the clearest, most brightly lit night she'd ever been and seen in the rainforest. The worst luck. She'd have to hope that no rain wings were out for a moonlit stroll tonight. Even through the thick canopy of the treetops overhead, she could see that two of the three moons were full.
Just like they were the night I left her here.
Secret Keeper stopped. Her heart seemed to be doing some kind of painful aerial loops in her chest.
Her.
Suddenly she just knew. She was certain. It would be female. She flew through the trees, following the small signs she'd left for herself. There wasn't time to travel quietly and cautiously. If a rain wing heard and followed her, well, it wouldn't be a good night for that rain wing. Plunging down, 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 toward the fallen tree, the artful pile of leaves, the curving ferns. Finally, she was here.
Finally!
Her egg was gone. Secret Keeper scrabbled frantically in the dark hollow. It couldn't be! It couldn't be gone! One black egg in the darkest hiding place in this gigantic rainforest. Who could have found it?
Where did they take it? I should have kept her with me. I shouldn't have lied to my tribe. I only wanted to protect her from that island, from the smoke and the smell, and the rules, and the misery, and from the constant fear that the earth would swallow us in fire at any moment. And now she's gone. This is my punishment for deceiving everyone. She whirled around, hissing, and her eye caught on something.
Not far away, there was a clearing. A clearing where the moons broke through the leaves of the trees and illuminated the forest floor. In the center of the moonbeams was her egg. At least, it had to be her egg. But it wasn't black anymore. The last time she'd been able to sneak out and check on it, 3 days ago, it had been ebony black, like every Nightwing egg. Now it was an eerie silver color, as polished and glimmering as if a piece of full moon had fallen from the sky. Secret Keeper approached it warily. Was this a trick? Was someone watching, waiting to catch her? Mastermind? Greatness? Or was there something wrong with her egg? 5 starburst-shaped cracks already marked the smooth surface of the silver shell. Secret Keeper circled it, inhaling the scents around it.
How did it roll over here? Why did it change color?
There were no clues in the mossy hollow where the egg now lay, bathed in moonlight. The egg rocked suddenly and a large crack splintered across the top of it. Secret Keeper felt a burst of panic. Was she supposed to help somehow? Should she crack the shell herself? Or try to keep the egg warm? She'd never seen a hatching before. There were so few hatchings on the Nightwing Island, and hardly anyone was allowed to attend them, for fear of contaminating the precious new dragonettes. If she hadn't lied to everyone about having stomach cramps during a hunt in the rainforest, about the egg coming out cracked, about burying the pieces alone, if she'd had her egg on the island, then she would probably have gotten to see a hatching in the last year. There had only been one. A dragonette called Mighty Claws. An expecting dragon would have been welcome to see how a hatching worked. But not a dragon who'd lost an egg. There were several dragons on the island whose eggs had cracked before they'd hatched, and it was considered a kindness to keep them apart from the healthy dragons and eggs. So Secret Keeper had no idea what to do. She'd never heard of an egg turning silver. Had she done something wrong when she laid the egg all alone? Had she hidden it in a place that was bad for it? Maybe she was supposed to be turning it every night or something like that. Maybe she'd already ruined the dragonette's life before it even hatched. And what would happen now? What if her dragonette was broken? After all the lying and worrying, she wasn't sure she could survive if there was something wrong.
I will love her anyway,
she thought fiercely, hoping that was true. Secret Keeper brushed away tears, trying to focus. No matter what, there was a living dragonette in that egg trying to get out. She crouched and gently wrapped her talons around the ink shell. The shell instantly splintered into 1,000 pieces, showering the ground with glittering shards. Sitting in between Secret Keeper's claws, blinking, was a tiny, black dragonette.
Oh!
Secret Keeper gasped. The dragonette looked up, up, up at her mother's head, and wings towering over her. She squeaked once, softly, and then stood up and shook herself, unfurling her own small wings. Secret Keeper stared at her in awe. She was perfect. perfect in every way. Her scales gleamed as though they'd been polished. Her claws were miniature curved crescents. Her tail was the most perfect tail Secret Keeper had ever seen. She already looked healthier than every Nightwing Secret Keeper knew. And that was enough. That was exactly why Secret Keeper had risked so much. She wished she could share this moment with the Dragonette's father, but he couldn't be trusted. He would almost certainly tell the tribe and insist she be raised on the island. If that meant he would never learn he had a daughter, then too bad. The Dragonette tilted her back to stare up at the two full moons, their silvery light reflected in her eyes. And Secret Keeper realized there was one odd thing about her. A silver scale shone on the outside corner of each eye, like a teardrop about to fall. Odd, but beautiful. Her small talons reached out toward the moons, as if she wanted to pull them out of the sky and roll them around. Secret Keeper picked her up, feeling large and unwieldy, with something so small and delicate. She lifted the dragon up to see the moons, and then brought her in close, cuddling her to her chest.
"I'm your mother, little one," she whispered. "I'm going to call you Moon Watcher. You're going to have the happiest life any dragon has ever had, and you're going to live forever and ever, and the volcano will never have you."
Moonwatcher squeaked again and leaned into her mother's warmth. Secret Keeper let go of the worrying and the guilt. She stopped thinking about what had happened or what was going to happen. She was right where she needed to be. A long, quiet time passed. And then...
"Secret Keeper!"
A voice bellowed from the treetops. Secret Keeper jolted awake. Her dragonette was curled in the curve of her wing, sleeping soundly. They were both brightly lit by the full moons overhead, and someone was shouting her name through the rainforest.
"Prey Hunter," she thought. "Idiot."
What if the rain wings heard him? Then she came fully awake and realized what would happen if he found her like this, with a secret Nightwing dragonette. Moonwatcher would be taken straight back to the island, and Secret Keeper would be punished for lying about her. She wasn't sure how, but she knew anything that involved being separated from Moonwatcher would be unbearable.
"Moonwatcher,"
she whispered urgently. Dragonette opened sleepy eyes.
"We have to hide."
"Ah?"
her daughter answered.
"Come here."
Secret Keeper scooped her up and hurried back into the darker shadows of the forest. Moonwatcher squeaked sadly and reached for the moonlight again.
"No, no, you can't go out there. You have to stay hidden, do you understand? You must not let any dragon find you except Mommy."
Secret Keeper crouched beside her hollow, where the fallen log and thick ferns created a hidden space. She tucked Moonwatcher into the shadows and started pulling foliage over her to conceal her. Moonwatcher asked. She reached out and caught one of her mother's claws in her small front talons.
"No, I can't stay,"
Secret Keeper said.
"I'm sorry. You'll be safer if I go."
Terrifying images flashed through her head. Nightwing hunters finding Moonwatcher by accident. Or Rainwings stumbling on her and taking her back to their own village. She couldn't. She mustn't be seen by any other dragons. What had Secret Keeper been thinking? Hiding an egg was one thing. Hiding a dragonette who could move and squeak and call for help was quite another.
How could Moonwatcher possibly understand something like this? I'll be back as soon as I can, Secret Keeper promised. Please, please don't leave this spot until I come. All right? She realized that Moonwatcher was staring intently into her eyes, almost as if she was reading the images flashing through her mother's mind. Is it possible? The scrolls say Nightwings once had mind-reading powers. But I thought that was just the lie we tell the rest of the tribe so they'll fear us. If it was ever true, it certainly hasn't been for the last several generations.
Still, there was something about the way Moonwatcher was looking at her. Not quite knowing what she was doing, Secret Keeper put her front talons gently on either side of Moonwatcher's head and whispered,
"Stay safe. Stay hidden. Stay secret."
She thought as hard as she could about the dangers of the rainforest and especially the dangers of other dragons. She pictured Moonwatcher curling into the ferns and not moving until her mother returned. Moonwatcher blinked and then nodded, slowly. She backed into the hollow and scratched leaves around herself.
Secret Keeper!
Prey Hunter shouted again. He sounded chillingly close.
See you soon, little one,
Secret Keeper whispered. Her claws wanted to clutch the earth, to stay right here with her dragonette and never, ever leave. It was harder than anything she'd ever had to do before. But she made herself turn and fly off into the trees. The tears came, and she let them. Perhaps if he saw her crying, Brayhunter would be too embarrassed to grill her about where she'd been for so long, and why she was coming back with no prey. Her wingbeats faded into the darkness, replaced by the chirping of crickets, the scurrying of lizards, and the stranger, more unidentifiable noises of the rainforest at night. Somewhere not too far away, a jaguar roared. Several moments passed. Said a small voice from the fern hollow. Nobody answered her. She said again, softly. She was alone, with the shadows firmly wrapped around her and no company except the frightening pictures her mother had left trailing through her mind. 2 hours old, and all she knew was that the world was a dangerous, terrifying place without her mother. Moonwatcher tried again. Rainforest noises. The small drip, drip, drop of rain starting to fall. A long pause, and then barely a whisper.
Mommy?
Part 1. Welcome to Jade Mountain. Chapter 1.
I don't want you to leave me here, Moon said.
She fit perfectly under her mother's wing, as if that spot had been shaped by the universe just for her. Like a sign, this is where you should be. Stay here for always.
Certainly do not let your mother abandon you on a windy mountaintop, positively swimming with strange dragons. They'd found a spot under a tree where they could watch the main arrival area for the school, which perhaps hadn't been the best idea, as now Moon was fairly sure she'd seen about 1,000 different kinds of dragons, all of them entirely too loud.
She shied away as two mudwings galloped past her, shouting and laughing. They looked so big and rowdy. How was she supposed to learn anything when she might get trampled at any moment by her fellow students? And what if they hated her? She wouldn't even have to do anything wrong, although that seemed awfully likely to happen anyway. They'd hate her just for being a Nightwing. Everybody did. Except the Nightwings, who hated her for not being enough of a Nightwing.
I really, really don't want to stay here, Moon said again. I know, her mother said kindly. But you have to, and it'll be good for you. I think you'll like it better than the Nightwing Village. You'll see.
At least Jade Mountain won't be full of Nightwings, her mind went on.
I like being wherever you are, Moon said, and I don't mind the other Nightwings that much. Most of them are awful, and you know it, Secret Keeper pointed out.
They were both thinking of the stares, the whispers, the open jealousy and hostility when Secret Keeper brought her healthy, well-fed dragonette back into the tribe. That was 6 months ago, after the volcano destroyed their island and all the Nightwings had moved into the rainforest. Queen Glory had officially forgiven her for breaking tribe rules, but that didn't mean anyone else had.
Here you'll be with much nicer dragons, like Sunny and Starflight. Remember, you met them and liked them? I want to be with you, Moon replied simply.
It wasn't fair to finally be given all the time she wanted with her mother, to be with her every moment of the day, instead of stolen hours a few times a week, and then have it taken away again.
I'll visit, her mother promised. You'll see me all the time, and you'll make friends here. I'm sure you will. Well, I hope you will, my weird little diamond. I'm not a weird little diamond, Moon protested.
Secret Keeper crouched and put her face right in front of Moon's. You need to stop doing that, remember? She whispered. If you only hear it in your head, don't respond. No one can know about your curse. Everybody thinks Nightwings don't have powers anymore. They won't know what to do with you if they find out.
And how will you make friends that way? Her mind worried. If you keep guessing their thoughts and making them uncomfortable. Or they might not believe you, and then they'll hate you for lying. So don't let them find out, all right? I know, Moon answered. Stay secret, stay hidden, stay safe.
All the years of pretending to have mind-reading powers had made the Nightwings truly fear the idea of any dragon reading their minds. She paused.
So, isn't this really dangerous? What if I make a mistake here, with all these different kinds of dragons around? You won't. You'll be careful, Secret Keeper said firmly. I know it's terrible to be the way you are, but if you keep it a secret, you can have a normal life. No one needs to know that you're not a normal dragon. Understand? Are you ready to go inside? Not yet, Moon said. Can we watch for a little longer?
Secret Keeper sighed.
Sure. She's so nervous all the time. I'm sure I was never that nervous when I was a dragonette.
Moon frowned up at her mother. She was glad the mind listening only went one way, but sometimes, like now, she wished her own mind could shout back.
Don't you think there's maybe a reason I'm like this? Oh, look,
Secret Keeper said obliviously, her eyes lighting up. She pointed to the sky where blue and green wings were sailing down toward them.
Sea wings. Do you see the one with the ropes of pearls? I think that's their queen. Queen Coral, Moon recited.
One thing she could do that didn't involve being stared at by other dragons or accidentally saying the wrong thing, was study, and so she'd done a lot of that to prepare for Jade Mountain Academy.
Those two must be her daughters, since she never lets them out of her sight. I don't know who the other one is.
Remember not to show off, her mother said. I mean, thank you for telling me, but the other dragons might not like you if you always know all the answers. Moon stared down at her claws. It was pretty clear from Secret Keeper's thoughts that her mother was a lot more worried about whether other dragons would like Moon than she was about whether Moon would like them. That, in fact, didn't seem to be among her concerns at all. A deep blue sea wing came barreling out of the entrance cave as the other sea wings landed. You came, she called happily. Her wings flared out and wrapped around the older daughter, who was a pale white pink, like the inside of seashells. The smaller daughter, who had to be less than a year old, bounced around their hug, yelping and trying to get in. She was attached to the queen by a long harness, which kept getting tangled under her talons and tripping her.
I'm really not sure about this, Queen Coral said in a rumbly voice.
She was the same shade of blue as the sea wing who was now being tackled by the little dragonette. In fact, Moon guessed they might be mother and daughter.
Ah, I'm a snail brain, she realized. That must be Tsunami.
The famous sea-wing princess from the prophecy had been in the rainforest for a while, but Moon hadn't met her before Tsunami left to work on getting the Jade Mountain Academy ready.
It'll be great, Tsunami promised the queen. I'll take care of an enemy, I promise.
She grinned at her sister.
Me too,
yelled the small dragonette.
I want to go to school too.
She pounced on her harness and wrestled it to the ground, growling at it.
You're much too young, Coral said sternly.
She tugged the little princess upright.
I can't risk anything happening to you, especially while an enemy is this far away. Maybe next year, Ocklet, Tsunami said.
The little dragon beamed hopefully. The queen frowned at Tsunami.
And I'm only letting this happen because an enemy has been badgering me about it every day since she got your message about the school. But you can come home any time, you understand? If you feel threatened, or lonely, or overworked, or tired, I'll be fine, an enemy said, wriggling away from her mother's hug.
Moon felt her own wings drooping.
Why didn't Secret Keeper want to keep her close like that? Why wasn't she getting a speech about coming home the moment she got lonely? Was it because her mother thought she was cursed? Maybe Secret Keeper really wanted to keep Moon as far away from her as possible.
Her thoughts never quite said that, but she'd learned to block some of them over the last 4 years. And she did worry all the time about Moon's mind reading. Moon wasn't sure she wanted to be normal if it meant grumbling around thinking her only thoughts. Only her thoughts, and mostly all about herself, the way most Nightwings did. But her mother seemed very sure that she'd be happier that way. Maybe acting normal was something she could learn here.
Who's this?
Tsunami asked, turning to the last sea-wing dragonette, who sat behind Queen Coral with a patient expression on his face. He looked about Moon's age, and he was dark green, like an emerald hidden in a cave, with flashes of blighter green underscales and hints of gold in his eyes. He was a little plump, with a sweet extra curve to his snout and upper arms, and his webbed talons were splayed out like he was worried the wind would shove him off the mountain. Unlike an enemy in Ocklet, he was not adorned with pearls and jewels. His only accessory was a kind of gold armband studded with glittering black rocks.
This is one of your brothers, Queen Coral said. He heard about this and really wanted to come too. Which one are you again?
Turtle, he said, shooting Tsunami a friendly smile.
one of my brothers, Tsunami echoed. I didn't realize... I mean, I guess I knew the male eggs were surviving every time your female eggs were destroyed by the orca statue. But I didn't even think about having brothers.
There are about 30 of us, Turtle said with a shrug.
30?
Tsunami shouted.
I have 30 brothers!
Well, 32, he said.
His gaze caught Moon watching, and he wrinkled his snout in an amused way.
Why didn't you mention this before?
Tsunami demanded, whipping toward her mother.
Who cares about them? Coral asked. They can't inherit the throne.
Moon tilted her head at Turtle, expecting a reaction, and realized she wasn't hearing any thoughts from him. Nothing at all. Just a quiet hum. Almost a soothing blankness. And that was strange. Moon had only met a few dragons who could block her reading at all. And then only sometimes. And they didn't even seem to know they could do it. A couple of Nightwings had prickly mental shields around some of their secrets. But Queen Glory was the best at it. The Rainwing Queen clearly wasn't intentionally shielding her thoughts from mind readers. But whenever she got uncomfortable, some kind of instinctive wall went up around her mind. She did the same thing with her scales, keeping them from showing her emotions. It was unsettling, but in a way that always made Moon really curious. What were they hiding? Was their shielding ability something they inherited, or something they instinctively developed? Turtle wasn't like Glory or those Nightwings. Though, his mind didn't feel like a thorny wall radiating,
"I've got secrets, keep out."
It was just serenely still. How was he hiding his thoughts so absolutely? He looked so placid and ordinary. On the other Talon, one thing Moon had been able to figure out so far was that nobody was ordinary on the inside. Tsunami rolled her eyes.
"Well, I'm happy to meet you, Turtle," she said. "I'm glad you're joining our school so I can get to know you better." "I want to see everything before I leave," said Queen Coral.
Moon caught twin threads of annoyance from Tsunami and Anemone, but Tsunami just nodded.
"Of course. Come inside."
As the sea wings disappeared into the cave, Turtle looked back at Moon one more time, and Moon suddenly had a dizzy, tilting feeling that the mountain was sliding down toward her. Darkness flashed before her eyes, and then a strange image, in bits and pieces like a puzzle whirling together. A beach. Sunlight. And Turtle pinning an enemy to the sand as the white-pink dragon writhed in pain. Then it was gone. And when she blinked, so was the Sea-Wing family.
Chapter 2 Moon shivered.
What was that?
But she knew.
She'd known since she read the scrolls that said,
"Nightwing powers include mind reading and visions of the future."
That was where her nightmares came from. The future. What she didn't know was whether the visions were inevitable, or how to interpret them, or what in Perea to do about them, since as far as she could tell, she was the first Nightwing in hundreds of years to have the legendary powers of the tribe.
Lucky me.
And if the other Nightwings wouldn't be able to handle mind reading, she was pretty sure visions from the future weren't going to go over well either. She hadn't even told her mother about those. One curse was bad enough. Turtle hadn't looked sinister at all, despite the weird blankness of his mind. And she knew quite a lot of sinister vibes after living with the Nightwings for the last few months. Perhaps any dragon could become dangerous as they got older,
although he hadn't looked much older or bigger in the vision. Perhaps he was simply much better at hiding his true nature than any other dragon she'd met before.
"Wow, a real queen," Secret Keeper said. "I've never seen one before." "You see Queen Glory all the time,"
Moon pointed out, only half listening.
"Queen Glory is barely older than you are," Secret Keeper answered. "I mean a real queen. Someone who's ruled her tribe for years and years."
Moon studied her mother sideways. Many of the Nightwings harbored bitter thoughts about having a Rainwing for their queen now, but she didn't think her mother was one of the grumblers.
"All right," her mother said, suddenly and briskly. "That's enough hiding in shadows and observing. Time for you to go find your cave." "Already?"
Moon was seized with a horribly familiar feeling of terror.
"Alone? Aren't you coming inside?" "This will be good for you," her mother said. "I hope. Remember, Secret Keeper, be strong. Just turn and fly away." "I love you, and I will see you soon."
Secret Keeper took a step back, averting her face, and Moon glimpsed a thought track her mother had been carefully burying.
"Oh, I hope this is the right thing. What am I doing? How do I know if this will be good for her?"
Moon's heart leaped.
"She doesn't want to leave me,"
she realized with a surge of hope. But her mother was already hugging her and whispering hurried goodbyes in her ear.
"Wait," Moon said desperately. "What if I came next year instead? What if..." "Trust me, Moonbud,"
her mother said, cupping Moon's snout in her front talons.
"You will love it here. Just keep your curse hidden, and you'll be fine. Act normal, no matter what happens. And write to me soon. Goodbye."
A moment later, Secret Keeper was just a dark shape winging away through the threadbare clouds, taking Moon's heart away with her. Moon stayed under the tree for a while, decidedly not crying, and watched more students arrive. There weren't actually 1,000, she knew. There were only 35 students, and it was a privilege to be one of the first few invited to attend, which made,
"Why me?"
an even more mysterious question.
"Well then,"
she thought, when she couldn't put it off anymore.
"Imagine this is the rainforest, and you're hungry, and your mother's been gone for 3 days, and you can smell a bunch of bananas inside the cave. If I could be brave enough to feed myself when I had to, I can be brave enough to walk into a school and find the place I'm supposed to be."
She shook back her wings, waited for a moment when all was quiet on the landing ledge, and darted forward into the yawning mouth of the entrance cave. "Hello!" a voice accosted her loudly, while Moon's eyes were still adjusting to the dimmer light inside. "Welcome to the Great Hall of Jade Mountain. Let me guess, you're a Moon Watcher, aren't you? I'm tremendously good at guessing. In fact, one might even say I'm mysteriously good at it." The welcoming dragon, whose scales were midnight black, lowered her voice.
"Almost as though I'm reading your mind, eh?"
Moon stared at the Nightwing in fright. Had she been discovered already, before even saying a word?
"What will Mother say?"
"Just kidding," said the older Nightwing. "Maybe. I'm Fate Speaker. I'm not a teacher like the others. I'm just helping wherever I can. Here's your welcome scroll and your map."
She thrust two scrolls into Moon's talons.
"Hey, look, you have silver scales next to your eyes, just like I do. Yours are bigger and sparklier, though. It is Moonwatcher, right?"
"Yes, Moon."
Now she recognized this Nightwing, which she should have been able to do from her first thought. She only knew two Nightwings apart from her mother, who didn't radiate gloom and anxiety. Starflight had a more thoughtful energy,
while Fate Speaker's hopefulness poured out of her like overenthusiastic sunlight. Moon had seen the two of them from afar in the Nightwing village several times, although they both had chosen to live with the Rainwings instead. She glanced around, wondering hopefully if Starflight was nearby. He was the Nightwing from the False Prophecy, and he'd been blinded when the volcano exploded. Usually Fatespeaker was with him, guiding him. But not today. The enormous cavern entrance looked as though it could fit 400 dragons comfortably, with room for more to soar overhead. Sunlight poured in, illuminating the craggy walls and rippling ceiling, where cascades of golden-brown stalactites hung down, some of them reaching all the way to the floor to form twisted columns. Hanging against the back wall was a huge bronze gong with three flying dragons carved into it. A banner of woven of green vines had been strung from one massive stalactite to the other in the center of the cave, with letters spelled out in giant purple and white flowers. Welcome, students! Two tunnel openings yawned along the left wall of the cave, two more on the right. Next to each one, a map was posted showing where the tunnels went. The whole cave was busy with bustling dragons, families saying goodbye, friends saying hello, a few dragons carrying around prey or scrolls. But Moon didn't see Sunny or Starflight anywhere, to her disappointment. Her mother was right. They had been kind to her, and Moon liked them. She particularly liked that, for the most part. Their thoughts matched what they said and did. Moon, 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 Fate Speaker muttered, rolling a scroll between her claws on the floor and scanning it closely.
Ah, here you are. Second tunnel on the left. Fifth cave on the right.
She flicked her tail and grinned at Moon.
You're gonna love your claw mates. Apparently I'm going to love all sorts of things, Moon thought,
and then she noticed what Fate Speaker had said.
Clawmates?
She echoed.
What are those? The dragons you're sharing a cave with, Fate Speaker said brightly.
Moon's wings shivered involuntarily, all the way out to her wingtips.
Sharing a cave? All the time? Ooh, here come some ice wings, Fate Speaker cried. Want to stick around and meet them? No thanks, Moon stammered.
She hurried to the second tunnel on the left, and as she turned into it, she heard a whoosh of wings and felt a cold chill sweep through the cave. She peeked back around the corner and saw two haughty-looking ice dragons pace inside, frowning. No, she definitely did not want to meet them now, or in fact, ever.
Fifth cave on the right,
Moon murmured to herself, moving on. The tunnel wound in a curving shape, like a slithering tail down into the mountain. Overhead, grass green and butterfly blue and hibiscus yellow glass globes hung from a wire strung on the ceiling, each of them glowing with fire so the walls were lit with color. It didn't feel like she was going underground. It felt more like the sunlit canopy of the rainforest. Moon had been picturing dark gray tunnels and cramped stone cave, but now that she thought about it, she realized Sunny wouldn't have wanted her school to be anything like the gloomy caves under the mountain where the prophecy dragonettes grew up. Soon the tunnel straightened out, and Moon could see several small cave openings along either side. This must be the corridor of sleeping caves. She could sense that some of them had two or three dragonettes inside already. Each cave she passed seemed to be bristling with chatter and wings and claws and spiky thoughts that clamored for space in her head.
Father said they have a library. I'm going to learn to read. Oh, I hope I'm not the only one who can't read yet. That would be so embarrassing. What do they eat up in the mountains? We'd better get sequels sometimes, and soon. Gosh, I'm hungry. Would anyone be mad at me if I went looking for sequels? I wonder where the prophecy dragonettes are. I wonder if they'll notice me. So cold here. I miss the desert. They really expect me to share a cave with a rainwing?
Moon scrunched her eyes shut, trying to hold back the headache. This was what it had been like when she first joined the Nightwing village. After the peace and quiet of a solitary life in the rainforest, all those voices in her head had been horrible shock, especially when they were all so resentful and hostile. And they still echoed in there, even though the Nightwings were too far away now for her to actually hear them.
It's not fair. Secret Keeper should be punished. I bet she thinks she's better than us. Imagine getting to eat every day. That dragonette doesn't know anything about our tribe, or what we went through living in the volcano. How can she ever be one of us?
She had a feeling, perhaps more of a wishful hope, that there should be a way to block out all the voices. But of course, there was no one who could teach her how to do that. Mostly, she dealt with the Nightwing noise by escaping to the tallest tree or farthest waterfall. But where could she go here? She'd be stuck in classes, or trapped in a cave with her clawmates. Her brain would always be full of the din of other dragons.
I'll figure it out. I'll make this work. Or I'll run back to the rainforest and deal with Mother's disappointment.
Moon opened her eyes again and fixed her gaze on the fifth cave. She squeezed past a pair of chattering sandwings, who were taking up most of the tunnel, and one of them stared at her intently with his obsidian black eyes.
Nightwing flashed through his head. Thornt doesn't like them. We just sent a couple back to Gloria as her prisoners. We have no idea what they can do in battle yet, especially if it's true they really have no powers at all. Needs further study. She's kind of cool looking, with those silver scales by her eyes. Seems nervous, twitching her wings back to look smaller than she is. Up to something? Or shy?
Moon tried not to look back at him as she went by. She tried to seem unobtrusive and harmless and part of the shadows. Her sleeping cave had a few stalactites hanging over the doorway like jagged teeth. She ducked inside and found more firelit glass globes strung along the ceiling in there. One green, one a fiery red gold, and one yellow. Two more globes, unlit, rested on ledges on either side of the door. And there was another at her level on the far side of the cave. She picked each one up and breathed a small flame onto the candles inside to set them alight, then surveyed the space nervously. It was nicer than she expected. The doorway made up one wall, and a sleeping spot had been arranged along each of the other three walls. One of these was a bare rock ledge, another was a pile of rainforest leaves and mosses, and the third was a woven green hammock, ingeniously suspended from the roof. Moon hesitated. It seemed as if these beds had been deliberately designed with different dragons in mind. But she wasn't sure which one was meant for her. She knew which one she wanted, but how would someone else have guessed what she'd like? Maybe she should wait for her clawmates and see what they wanted.
I wish I could have a private cave. Maybe if I asked a starflight really nicely.
She noticed that there were also five mahogany scroll racks arranged around the cave, about the height of her foreleg. Each polished until they were as smooth as her scales. There was an empty one next to each bed, and one on either side of the door. She took a closer look, and realized with a jump of happiness that the ones by the door were filled with scrolls. A little sign above these two said, "Free reading. Hope you like them." Moon slid her welcome scroll and her map scroll into one of the empty racks, then wrapped her tail around her back talons and started going through the scrolls by the door. It was a mix of all the kinds of things that interested her. History,
adventure stories, ancient legends, encyclopedias of all the plants and animals in each tribe's territory. Suddenly, she remembered Starflight finding her with a scroll one day. He'd quizzed her on what she'd like to read.
If he chose these for me, he must have really been listening.
She noticed that there weren't any of the recent scrolls about the Dragonets of the Prophecy and
their epic quest to end the War of Sandwing Succession.
She guessed with a smile that whoever had selected these, Starflight, Sunny, Glory, found those particular scrolls rather embarrassing. She also found one early reader scroll that must have been written for tiny dragonettes, with giant letters and a guide to the alphabet. This seemed so out of place that she sat and puzzled over it for a minute.
Is this for one of my clawmates? Am I going to be living with a one-year-old?
Her mother had mentioned that the academy would take dragonettes of various ages, so maybe it was possible, although it seemed weird. Out of nowhere, though, Moon felt a sudden burst of angry energy like a spear driving through her scroll. She crumpled forward, clutching her head as shouts and roars echoed in the hall.
Get your fish-smelling tail away from me!
I faced bigger sea wings than him in battle if he's trying to start something. Don't you dare blow smoke in my face! She could be one of the sky wings who destroyed our summer palace.
Ow! Moon whispered. Ow! Ow!
The headache was so blistering, she considered running into the rock wall to knock herself out. And then, very softly, under all the yelling, she heard,
"Aha! There you are."
Moon's head snapped up, and she winced as another bolt of pain crackled through it. This voice, it was unlike anything she'd ever heard before. It sounded crisp and clear and right in her ear, as if it was talking to her.
"I am talking to you."
The instinctive fear whipped through Moon's veins, paralyzing her. All of her mother's nightmare scenarios started playing again in her head.
Don't trust anyone new. Don't trust anything unusual. Don't let anyone know what you can do. Stay secret. Stay hidden. Stay safe.
"Three moons," said the voice. "Aren't you a jumper one, jumpy one?"
"Who are you?" Moon whispered.
"Who are you?" it answered back, and then, as if the speaker had plucked the answer from her thoughts, "Hello, Moon Watcher."
Another telepath. How was that possible? Moon tried to push back. She imagined reaching out with her talons, trying to grab onto the voice and open up what was happening in the mind behind it.
"It's as if you've had no training at all," the voice chuckled. "How old are you?"
Again, the pause. And this time, Moon thought furiously of as many different numbers as she could.
95, 76, 12.
4 already, and that's all you can do?
"Who are you?" Moon demanded. "How are you doing that?"
"You really have no idea,"
the voice mused with a hint of puzzlement.
Fascinating. Let me think about that."
She listened, pressing her temples to hold the headache at bay. But the voice didn't come back.
"Are you still there?"
she whispered.
No response.
Did I imagine it? Maybe I imagined it. Maybe the headache and all the noise out there just confused me. Or maybe mind reading is really finally driving me crazy.
She shook her head and blinked.
But if it was a real mind reader, maybe they could teach me how to use my powers.
Or expose me to everyone, now that they know who I am while I have no idea who they are. Moon drew her wings around her with an anxious shiver.
"Hey now. Hey there, stop! Stop! Stop!"
A real voice called in the hallway, interrupting the squabble.
Clay!
Clamored several voices at once in Moon's head.
It's him! It's really him! Ooh, he's even cuter in real life. Look at his heroic limp. I think he looked at me.
Moon poked her head out of her cave and saw the large, sloping back of the prophecy mudwing. Clay was gently holding apart a writhing sea wing and a hissing sky wing.
It's only the first day, folks, he said genially. Nothing to be so grumpy about already. You're probably both just hungry. Carnelian, take a deep breath and see me later. Pike, walk with me.
He spread his wing over the sea wing's shoulder and firmly guided him away down the tunnel. The Skywing watched them go with narrow eyes, growling to herself. Then, to Moon's alarm, she swung around and marched right into Moon's cave. Without saying a word, she threw herself onto the rock ledge bed, folded her large scarlet wings forward over her eyes, and proceeded to stew in sullen silence.
One of my clawmates, Moon realized. Yay.
She blinked at the Skywing for a moment, wondering if she should say something. Her heart was beating fast and the headache was still there, receding slowly toward the back of her skull. She cleared her throat, swallowed, opened her mouth, and then gave up and turned back to the scrolls. Several minutes later, a whirlwind burst into the cave, nearly trampling Moon with bright yellow talons.
Oh my gosh, sorry, it yelped. I didn't even see you there. I guess that's a Nightwing skill, hiding in shadows, right?
They put me in with a Nightwing? Hollered her brain.
Hello, isn't anyone worried about my potential post-traumatic stress? But the little Rainwing didn't drop her enormous smile for a moment. Her scales, too, didn't shift. They stayed a blindingly bright banana yellow, dotted with splotches of alarming raspberry pink.
She seized Moon's front talons and pumped them cheerfully up and down.
Isn't this exciting? I'm so excited I can hardly stand it. That's why I'm this color, by the way. I've been trying all morning to turn myself something more dignified, and I can't do it. My scales are all like, yay, we're really here, and will not listen to me.
Moon noticed that there was one spot on the Rainwing that wasn't eye-meltingly colorful. A triangle of three small black smudges on her wing that looked like tiny splashes of ink.
I'm Kinkajou, the Rainwing added, beaming.
You're noisy,
the Skywing observed from under her wings.
I love this place,
Kinkajou said. She let go of Moon and bounced over to the hammock, while her thoughts went essentially,
library, art, friends. Have you explored it all yet? That's the most amazing library. Not that I can read yet, but, oh my gosh, I'm working on it really hard. And an art cave. It's full of all these colors of paint, like a couple of rain wings emoted all over it. You guys, we should make amazing paintings and then decorate our cave with them. Wouldn't that be amazing?
I might literally die of joy, said the Skywing flatly.
You look way healthier than most of the other Nightwings,
Kinkajou said to Moon, evidently deciding to ignore the Skywing for the moment.
Your scales are so shiny. I'd almost guess you are a Rainwing in disguise. But you're not, are you?
I didn't grow up on the volcano,
Moon said softly.
My mother hid my egg in the rainforest. Oh,
Kinkajou said, and her brain went,
aha! I've heard of you. Wow, that's relief. That means you weren't anywhere near the Nightwings who locked me up. I mean, I'm all for amnesty and making friends across tribes and forgiving each other and everything. But seriously, it was scary there. Like, I thought I might actually die, and so I figured maybe I'd start by making friends with some other tribes first, and gradually work my way back around to the Nightwings, but you're hardly a Nightwing at all, so that's okay then.
Moon winced. Hardly a Nightwing at all was essentially what she'd been hearing in the Nightwing's thoughts about her for months. It was a little brutal to hear someone just say it aloud.
So, what's your name? Kingaju asked. Moon. I mean, Moonwatcher. But just Moon, really. Sure, Moon. And who are you?
Kingaju asked the Skywing. I'm a warrior, the Scarlet Dragon thought bitterly, keeping her face hidden. A loyal soldier in Ruby's army who never did anything to deserve this. This punishment of schooling and being forced to live with Ditzy and Mumbles over there. Moon hunched her shoulders and looked down at her claws. That wasn't fair. She did not mumble. Kingaju turned back to Moon, her eyes sparkling.
Ugh, it's a mystery, she said. We have to guess our third clawmate's name. I'll go first. I bet it's Squelch. What do you think? Squelch is a cute name, right?
Moon didn't think she ought to smile, given the wave of outrage coming off the Skywing.
Squelch is a Mudwing name, isn't it?
She pointed out.
Oh, true, said Kinkajou. Maybe her name is Friendly. That would suit her so well. That's not a Skywing name either, Moon said.
The red dragon's tail was twitching dangerously.
Think outside the box, Moon. Look at her. I'm sure she'd love to be called Friendly. Let's do that until we find out her real name,
Kinkajou said, and then broke down in helpless giggles. The Skywing unfolded herself majestically and glared at Kinkajou with her eyes. Her wings spread wide.
I have fought in 14 battles, the Skywing thundered. No one giggles at me. Least of all a Rainwing who can't even read and knows nothing about war.
She jumped off her ledge and swept furiously out the door. There was a pause while Kinkajou got her giggles under control.
Ouch, she said. But mostly fair. Although I think I being imprisoned and experimented on by Nightwings and then injured during a royal challenge should give me some battle credit, don't you? I think Clay said her name is Carnelian, maybe?
Moon offered.
Oh, that's pretty, Kinkajou said. Do you mind if I take the hammock, by the way?
Moon shook her head.
The moss bed is all right with me. And that's what you slept on while you were growing up on the rainforest floor, right?
Kinkajou guessed, nodding.
This will be so great. We can bond over how much we miss papayas and adorable sloths. But I don't miss anything yet. It's too fabulous here. Come see the library.
Moon said nervously.
I think I'll just stay here for a bit longer. I need to just... Nonsense,
Kinkajou said. She poked one of Moon's wings with her own.
We're in a new place. This is really exciting. I want to show you everything. Oh, I hope she's not boring,
Kinkajou's mind whispered.
I don't mind shy. I can handle shy, but please don't be boring. Moon straightened her shoulders and folded her wings back. It meant trampling down her terror, but she absolutely did not want to seem boring to her first possible chance at a friend here. All right, let's go, she said, taking a deep breath. Yay!
Kinkajou cried. She bounded out the door and Moon followed. As she stepped into the hallway, she heard it again, that bell of a voice in her mind. Oh, Moonwatcher, my new favorite dragon. This dragonette with her brain full of bubbles is not your only possibility. I believe you and I are destined for a great friendship. Moon shivered. Was it real? Was there a dragon somewhere reaching out to her? If so, how? And who was it? Another student? Was it a fellow Nightwing mysteriously hatched with the tribe's long-lost powers, just like her? How could she hide from someone who knew exactly what she was? I can help you, the voice whispered. And better yet, you can help me.
Chapter 3. Moon couldn't handle a mystery mind voice in a new school full of noisy dragons all at the same time. She shoved her worries about the voice to the back of her head and tried instead to wrestle with the exhausting energy radiating off Kinkajou.
Where are we going?
Moon asked the Rainwing as they headed along the tunnel, past all the sleeping caves, away from the Great Hall. She wondered if she should have brought her school map.
Today is an exploring day, Kinkajou said with authority. They want every day to be a kind of interesting day. That's the idea of the school. Find out what you're interested in and explore it. I'm interested to go back to my mother,
Moon thought.
Can I explore that? They?
She echoed instead.
The Dragonettes of Destiny, Kinkajou said. Although they don't want anyone to call them that anymore. But what are we supposed to call them? The founders of the school make sense too, I guess. But that makes them sound like they're perfectly ancient. Like old slabs of rock way under the mountain. I'm really good friends with them,
she confided as streaks of dark purple shot through her scales.
Especially Queen Glory. We're practically best friends. They knew I wouldn't be able to read the announcements. Everywhere. I mean, not yet. So Sunny and Clay explained their whole plan to me ahead of time.
Announcements? Moon paused to look around and saw a small rectangular board made of dark rock hanging under one of the torches. A note was written on it in chalk.
Welcome to the Jade Mountain Academy. Feel free to explore the whole school today and every day. Everything is for you. Food is available in the Prey Center. Talk to Clay if you'd like to sign up for a hunting party. Please come see any of us anytime with questions or requests or worries or anything. More information about tomorrow will be posted tonight. Small group discussion classes will begin in the morning. Have a wonderful day.
What's a small group discussion class? Moon wondered. It's exactly what it sounds like, Kinkajou said. Come on, come on.
She tugged on Moon's wing impatiently, and the physical contact flooded Moon with Kinkajou's radiant excitement. Kinkajou bounded up a side corridor lined with hanging scrolls. As she followed, Moon saw that each scroll had a quote on it. She didn't have time to read them all, but she saw,
"Knowledge is a flame in the darkness," and "The claws of war are no match for the wings of wisdom."
At the end, they turned into a space full of iridescent green sunlight. It was like stepping into a dream. Scrolls were everywhere, simply everywhere, in cubbyholes along the walls and more racks and cylinders around the cave. Every corner had a spot to curl up and read in, sometimes a rock ledge, sometimes a pile of moss, or an arrangement of carpets. Only one reader was in, a quiet-looking mudwing with a scroll curled on some reeds. She didn't look up as they came in. The only image Moon got from her mind was something like ripples on a mud puddle. Sunbeams filtered down through skylights in the roof and windows along one wall. Each of the holes was covered with something thin enough to let the light through, but strong enough to keep the wind and weather out. Moon tilted her head back and studied the closest one. Emerald green, with traces of vines branching through it.
Leaves, she whispered. Sunny and Glory got them in the rainforest,
Kinkajou said proudly.
We use them sometimes as roofs for our rainwing houses. Aren't they perfect for library windows? Hi, Starflight!
She bounded over to a circular wooden desk in the center that was labeled Librarian. A dark head popped up from behind the desk.
Hey, Kinkajou,
The blind Nightwing leaned forward with a smile as Kinkajou brushed his claws with hers.
Is that Moon with you?
Hi,
Moon said shyly. There was nothing ever hurtful in Starflight's thoughts. His brain was always busy, 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 but he never thought of her as not a real Nightwing, or dangerous and untrustworthy. He was like her, an outsider in his own tribe. And he liked scrolls too. She could hear the back of his mind ticking through all the things he still needed to do to get the library completely ready. But he smiled in the direction of her voice. Here's your library stamp, he said, sliding something out from under the desk. I thought you might come by today.
Library stamp?
Moon echoed curiously, taking it from him. It was a small rectangle of wood, as long as two claws, with her name carved backward in raised letters on one side.
We're testing out a system, he said. I'll show you.
He brushed his talons over a roll of scrolls lined up under the desk. Moon spotted a name carved at the wooden end of each one, arranged alphabetically. Starflight touched them lightly until he felt hers, which he pulled out and partially unrolled. The scroll was completely blank.
When you want to borrow a scroll, he said, you bring it up to me here. Each one has a unique carved stamp in the end, just like these do. I'll stamp your name scroll with that end to show that you checked it out. And then when you bring it back, we stamp your card over the next, over the first image to show that it's been returned. Does that make sense?
I think so,
Moon said. She turned the stamp over in her claws. She'd never had anything that was really her own before.
Can she have a pouch to keep it in?
Kinkajou asked.
Of course.
Starflight fumbled under the desk for a few minutes and then pulled out a soft black leather pouch on a silver chain. Moon slipped the stamp inside the pouch and put the chain over her neck. It felt like her very first treasure.
Thank you, she said.
Let me know if I can help you find anything, he said.
She heard a flurry of worried what-ifs start up in his mind, circling a well-worn track of anxiety about how to be a blind librarian. She also heard him firmly beat those worries back. He smiled in her direction again.
I've been practicing to get the whole space memorized.
Moon wondered how she could ask for what she really needed.
Do you have any scrolls about ominous voices in your head?
Zora, are you still here?
Starflight asked, raising his voice a little. The mudwing by the windows lifted her head and nodded.
He can't see you,
reminded Kinkajou in a loud whisper.
Yes, she's still here.
Sorry,
the brown dragon said softly.
It's all right,
Starflight said. The twinge of sadness in his thoughts didn't spill into his voice.
Sora, this is Kinkajou and Moon. Sora is one of Clay's sisters.
Ooh, Kinkajou said. How does it feel to be related to someone famous? Probably a bit like being best friends with a queen,
she answered herself, grinning ridiculously.
Which I am, just incidentally. So, I mean, I totally get it.
Sora's smile was shy, and now Moon could sense tremors of anxiety in her that felt an awful lot like Moon's own fears. Clay's sister was as nervous about being here as Moon was. It was sort of reassuring, actually, to find someone as scared as she was.
Nice to meet you,
Moon said.
Maybe she could be my friend, too. Maybe Mother was right. Maybe I will meet dragons I like Maybe I will meet dragons I like here. You too?
Sora nearly whispered, rolling her scroll between her talons.
Let's go to the music wing next, Kinkajou said. Woo, I heard there's an old ghost living somewhere in Jade Mountain. Maybe we can find him.
Moon's ears twitched. A ghost? Was she hearing the voice of a ghost? That would be unsettling.
You're talking about Stone Mover, Starflight said. And he's not a ghost. He's Sunny's father. And he's a perfectly nice old Nightwing who's lived here for ages. He sleeps a lot and doesn't need little dragonettes sneaking up on him or pouncing on his tail to find out if he's real. He does like company, though, so if you're interested in a polite conversation with him, I can tell you how to find him.
Polite conversation? Yawn,
Kinkajou said with a shrug of her wings.
You should tell everyone he's a ghost. That would be much more exciting.
Not a ghost, but a real Nightwing, Moon thought. Maybe he's the one who can talk in my head?
She'd have to ask Starflight for directions later, if she could work up the courage.
Are you hungry, Moon? Kinkajou barreled on. I might be hungry. We can find the Parade Center. I haven't done that yet. Which way to the Parade Center, Starflight?
He touched his desk lightly as if orienting himself, and then pointed at one of the three corridors that led away from the library.
Sora, you want to come?
Kinkajou asked before Moon can think to invite the dragonette herself. The Mudwing shook her head quickly and buried her nose in her scroll again.
All right, see you soon,
Kinkajou called over her shoulder as they left. This passageway slanted back down, and Moon thought, out toward the open air. They passed a couple of branches, but Kinkajou barely glanced down at them before continuing straight. After a few minutes, Moon caught the scent of living prey up ahead, and the jumble of several voices, both real world and inside her head. Uh-oh. It was worse than it sounded. The prey center was total chaos, the opposite of the serene, well-ordered library. It was a mammoth cave open to the air on one side, looking out over a mossy, boulder-strewn slope. Towering cliffs and faraway peaks. There was a low wall of rocks built across the bottom of the opening. Useless against dragons, of course, but perfect for keeping prey trapped inside. A fast-flowing river swept along the wall opposite the opening, disappearing through an archway into the next cave. And there was prey all over the place. Shaggy, bleating sheep blundered helplessly under the dragon's talons, yelling in panic. Several speckled brown chickens, quail, and pheasants were racing around the floor, periodically bursting skyward in an explosion of feathers and squawks. In one corner, a fat black bear was squaring off with a dragonette twice its size, growling. Worse still, the cave was filled with shouting dragons. Most of them were Mudwing, Sandwing, and Skywing dragonettes, who were gleefully trying to corner the rampaging chickens. They bellowed instructions at one another, yowled when the pheasants dodged them, and shrieked hilariously whenever birds nearly flew up their snouts. At the same time, their minds were all shouting, worrying, planning, reacting, and it felt to Moon like 100 dragons talking at once. Clay, meanwhile, was standing on a tall boulder in the middle of the cave, trying to shout over all the noise.
"Everyone stop moving," he bellowed. "Especially you, chickens. Chickens, give up. We're going to eat you. There's nothing you can do about it. Stop running away right now."
The chickens shrilled back. Kinkajou spotted a small mountain of fruit piled near the river and darted over to it. Another Rainwing dragonette was there, picking through the options, and Kinkajou shouted something cheerful at him. Moon hesitated, wishing she could sink right into the mountain and disappear. She was hungry, but it was so loud and horribly overwhelming in here. Maybe she should sneak back to her cave and wait to eat until the middle of the night. Surely it would be quieter then. But Kinkajou spotted her as she tried to sidle away. The Rainwing flapped her wings wildly, beckoning, and finally Moon had to duck her head and sprint over, hoping not to get hit by any chicken parts on her way.
Moon, this is my friend Coconut, Kinkajou said. Thought he was my friend,
shimmered through her mind, and Moon had a moment to wonder if Kinkajou did have a dark, bitter side after all, before Kinkajou added blithely,
At least, I thought he was my friend until I got abducted by bad guys for 3 weeks, and he didn't even notice I was gone.
She poked him pointedly with her tail.
Didn't I say I was sorry about that?
Coconut mumbled around a mouthful of papaya. His scales were a kind of quiet lavender blue, and his eyes were sleepy.
Or did I?
Something like that.
Mostly, you say.
What?
Every time I bring it up, Kinkajou said.
She turned to Moon.
I'm going to learn to read eons before he does.
Why is that? Coconut asked mildly.
Because I'm smart and you're not, Kinkajou pointed out. That was implied, Coconut. It was subtext.
Right, he said, not in the least offended. Perhaps because he only seemed to be partially following the conversation.
The mangoes are pretty good, he said to Moon. I was told to eat them first because they're all ripe. I like bananas better, but mangoes are fine. I don't particularly like coconut, though.
Ironically, Kinkajou said.
What?
He said.
See,
she said to Moon, grinning. Moon nodded, unable to speak through the cacophony inside and outside her ears. At least Coconut's thoughts were slow and meaningless, although she thought she might go mad if she had to listen to them all day long. He passed her 3 mangoes, and she sliced them over, open with her claws, the way she'd taught herself to do when she was alone in the rainforest, during one of her mother's longer absences.
Oof!
Said a voice behind her. Moon jumped and nearly dropped her mangoes in the river.
It's just me, Clay said to her kindly. I'm glad you found Kinkajou. I thought you two would be a good match.
You did?
Moon thought with bewilderment. She couldn't see anything in common between herself and the bubbly rainwing. Clay shooed a chicken away from the fruit and glanced around the tumultuous cave.
He said, my plan hasn't exactly gone as planned.
Clay, this place is madness,
Kinkajou said with a laugh.
I know, he said ruefully. We'll try something different tomorrow. I thought it would be fun to bring in live prey and let everyone chase it around. That's what we did in our cave sometimes growing up, when the guardians wanted us to practice hunting, but wouldn't let us go outside. But I guess it was a little more manageable with 5 dragonets than 35.
He wrinkled his snout at the nearest panicking sheep. Kinkajou shook her head.
Nice anyone who is gross enough to eat something that's alive and wriggling deserves to get pecked. You should take those dragons out hunting with you and leave the rest of us here to enjoy our quiet, sensible fruit in peace.
That's a good idea, Clay said. In the meanwhile, maybe I'll get Tsunami and see if she can help me calm things down.
He gave Moon another reassuring smile and hurried out of the prey center. Moon heard the words quiet and peace and calm as if from a long way away. Through the raucous noise of the dragon mines around her, she could sense something running toward the cave. Something like a small thread of pure terror. So tiny it could be blown away in a breeze, but so intense she couldn't miss it, even in the howling gale of emotions in the prey center.
Who is that? And why is their mind so strange?
There were no words to go along with the emotions, and there was something fuzzy about it. Could it be a really young dragonette? She lifted her head and turned to watch for it, but as she did, a vast icicle of cold fury stabbed through her brain, and she staggered back, crushing the mangoes in her talons from an involuntary convulsion. Bright yellow-orange pulp splattered all over Kinkajou and Coconut and the rocks around them. Kinkajou let out a startled yelp, but before Moon could apologize or even get speech back under her control, a louder commotion erupted near one of the tunnels.
"Catch it! Mine! I claim it! Mine! It went that way!"
All the Mudwings and Skywings abandoned the chickens at once and bolted over to that side of the cave. Moon felt the thread of fear twist higher and brighter, as if it had been set on fire, and then a small shape shot between the dragons and came pelting across the cave, dodging sheep and chickens, and Moon saw what everyone was chasing.
A scavenger!
She'd read about them and seen drawings, but she'd never encountered a real scavenger before. She'd never given them much thought. Apart from stealing the Sandwing treasure and killing Queen Oasis 20 years ago, they were just creatures who happened to live on the same planet as the dragons. But suddenly, this one was right here and blazing in her mind as brightly as any dragon. She saw it spot the sheep and chickens, including the ones that had been caught and half-eaten already, and she saw it stumble as a bolt of despair went through it.
"Why can I feel the scavenger's fear, but nothing from the sheep or chickens?" she wondered. "Aren't they the same?"
The icy anger she'd felt before swept into the cave like an avenging blizzard. An ice wing, pale blue as a frozen ocean, with glittering scales like overlapping chips of ice. He stormed through the yelling crowd of dragonettes who were still trying to find the scavenger underfoot, and Moon realized he was chasing the little animal as well. The scavenger didn't stand a chance. He'd fled into the worst possible place. Someone in the prey center was definitely going to catch him and eat him, and Moon wouldn't have to feel his awful terror as it happened. And Moon would have to feel his awful terror as it happened. She couldn't watch it die. She couldn't let that happen to something so scared, so helpless and alive and alone, and clearly aware of what was about to happen to it. Moon bolted over to the scavenger, cut it off as it tried to dodge around her, darted left to block its retreat, and deftly snatched it up in her claws.
"It's all right," she whispered to it. "I'm not going to hurt you."
It did no good. The scavenger's heartbreaking fear buzzed even more clearly in her mind now that she was holding it. It put its little paws over its head and curled into a ball between her talons. Silence slowly spread across the cave. Moon looked up and found the ice wing only inches away, glaring at her with dark blue eyes. "Nightwing," he thought with a flash of vicious hatred that made her wince. He hissed slowly, exhaling a hint of deadly frost breath into the air between them. "You have 10 seconds to give me back my scavenger," he snarled, "before I slice your face off."